บิสมิลลาฮิรเราะห์มานิรเราะฮีมอัลฮัมดุลิลลาฮิร็อบบิลอาลามีนอัสศอลาตุวัสสลามุอะลาอัชรอฟิลอันบิยาอ์วัลมุรสะลีนวะอะลาอาลิฮิวะซอห์บิฮิอัจมะอีนร็อบบิสรอห์ลิซอดรีวะยัสริลีอัมรีวะฮลุลดัตันมินลิซานียัฟกะฮูกอลีอัลฮัมดุลิลลาห์ segala puji-pujian dan kesyukuran kita panjatkan kehadrat Allah Subhanahu wa taala kerana dengan izin dan di atas limpah kurnia-Nya maka kita dapat bersama-sama dalam RGRSM 2020 pada hari ini. Selawat dan salam kita panjangkan kepada junjungan besar Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ahli-ahli keluarga baginda serta para sahabat baginda yang setia. And let us also not to forget to give our recognition to all our prominent surveying and geospatial forefathers for their wisdom, courage and determination in shaping the profession and industry into a level that we are enjoying right now. May Allah grant them with all the blessings and everlasting reward. Amin. And I would also like to thank the organizer, the IGRSM, for this opportunity. It is an honor and a privilege for JUPERM and to me personally to speak virtually before all of you who share the same interests as we all have here in the field of geospatial. Ladies and gentlemen, I am sure that when we talk about geospatial, the first thing that comes to mind is positions or locations. But how can we describe our position or where we are on Earth? Before we answer that question of where we are on Earth, perhaps it would be useful to first look at the position of the Earth with respect of the Sun and the Moon as shown in this slide here. Here we can see the Earth's journey as it goes around the Sun. We are now in the month of October. The Earth right now has already passed 3/4 of its way in its orbit around the Sun. So we have slightly more than 2 months more to go before the year 2020 ends. The Islamic date today is the 3rd of Rabiul Awal, 1442 Hijriah, meaning that the moon has just passed the conjunction. If you were to go out this evening, you probably can see the moon crescent quite high at least 40 degrees high in the western sky before sunset today. Something like these images here, ladies and gentlemen. This is one of my interests, my passion, to carry out moon sighting almost every month for the past 20 years or 30 years or so. These are some of the images of the moon crescent or anak bulan or hilal, and this should remind us of a verse from the Holy Quran. And the moon we have measured for it mentions to traverse till it returns like the old dried curved dead stalk. It is not for the sun to overtake the moon, nor does the night outstrip the day. They all float each in an orbit. Surah Yasin, verse 39 to 40 of the Holy Quran. The last verse, Kulun fi falakin yasbahun. They all float each in an orbit. MashaAllah, ladies and gentlemen, this ayat was revealed more than 1,400 years ago, but applicable then as it is now until Qiyamah. MashaAllah. But then, ladies and gentlemen, coming back to my original question, just where on Earth are we actually? Where on Earth are we? Do we have a way of describing where something is on the Earth? Yes, we do. We use a system of latitude and longitude. Latitude simply describes how far your position is from the equator. Here are some photos of the Equatorial Monument in Pontianak, which is a town in Borneo Island, Indonesia. Now Pontianak lies exactly on the equator itself. And you can go there, just a short flight from Kuala Lumpur, and have a photo of yourself standing on the equator. So at zero latitude, you are neither on the north, nor are you on the south. Why? Because you are right on the equator. Longitude, on the other hand, tells you how far your position is from Greenwich near London. So in this photo, my position is neither east nor west, but rather I am standing exactly on the zero longitude of Greenwich. So that is the Earth's coordinates, latitude and longitude. But what about the sky coordinates? In order to understand the sky coordinates, ancient astronomers had introduced the concept of celestial sphere, or sphera samawi, or in Malay, where all the stars, the moon, the sun, all are assumed to be attached to this very big imaginary sphere, with the Earth at its center. And on the celestial sphere, the positions of the stars are described using declination and the right ascension. So there we have it, ladies and gentlemen, two systems of describing the positions. On Earth, we have the latitude and longitude, and in the sky, we have the declination and the right ascension. So now, ladies and gentlemen, now that we have a system of latitude and longitude for our position on Earth, we can now be able to tell our unit positions of exactly where we are on Earth. And to translate that theoretical system of latitude, longitude into a more practical system, we need to understand the concept of our coordinate reference system. Now, coordinate reference systems have been established in many countries around the world, including Malaysia, since the turn of the 19th century. Most of them use local datums that are confined to small areas of the globe, fit to limited areas to satisfy national mapping requirements during that time. This is also the case with Malaysia, where my department, as the sole authority in geospatial activities, through a government mandate in 1965 through a National Mapping Committee, NMC. But now, it is known as the National Mapping and Spatial Data Committee, or GPDSN. And the Director General of JUPEM is the chairman, with members from agencies that also deal with geospatial. So that if you want to carry out any survey or you want to produce any maps or plans, you must connect and or relate your work to our geodetic infrastructure. So in this slide, JUPEM has in place two old classical triangulation networks, namely the MRT 1968 and the BT68 for Sabah and Sarawak. Then, in the early 1990s, JUPEM began to use GPS technology with the eventual objective of adopting a global unified datum for Peninsular Malaysia, Sabah and Sarawak. And this had led to the establishment of this PMGSN-94 for Peninsular Malaysia and EMGSN-97 for Sabah and Sarawak. And it comprises 238 stations in Peninsula and 171 stations in Sabah and Sarawak. Then, beginning 2002, JUPEM further developed a modern active GNSS network with the latest state-of-the-art technology to establish the MyRTK network, comprising 96 stations altogether. And this new MyRTK net system is able to provide real-time positioning services at centimeter level accuracy to users in the field. And this network continuously collects GPS data, and this MyRTK net is connected via telco line to the control center situated at JUPEM headquarters in Kuala Lumpur, and giving GPS corrections as well to real-time users in the field. So that was the story then. So if you want to know just where you are exactly on the Earth, then you need to have a tie-up to any one of those geodetic stations, whether you want to tie to our old triangulation net stations or to the modern GPS network or to a more modern MyRTK net. But then, the big question is, are our station coordinates correct? Are our stations that you want to tie is correct? Of course, the short answer will be yes. Our station coordinates are correct. But let me give you the long answer. Ladies and gentlemen, a discussion on coordinate reference system cannot be complete without touching on the tectonic setting in the Southeast Asia region. Actually, we owe much of our knowledge about plate tectonics to this gentleman here, by the name of Alfred Wegener. he was a German meteorologist and astrophysicist. And he, in 1912, put forward concepts of continental drift and sea floor spreading. And he actually hypothesized that the present continents once formed a single landmass that over million and million of years have drifted apart to the present positions. And that hypothesis eventually led to the theory of plate tectonic. So in the case of the Earth, it is believed that there are 8 major tectonic plates and quite a number of minor plates. They are represented here in the slide here by the blue lines, sort of floating around on the surface of the Earth. And these plates are in constant motion with each other at a rate that is a few centimeters per year, and thus it continuously reshaping the Earth's exterior in doing so, because they collide with each other, either causing, for example, creating the Himalayas if it is a collision between two continental plates, between Eurasia and India plates, or it involves a collision between an oceanic plate and a continental plate, for example, between the Australian plate versus the Sundaland plate that we are all sitting right now. The Australian plate goes down underneath the less than Sundaland, and this was the case in 2004 when a mega earthquake struck Aceh and caused a large tsunami. We will touch on this later part of my presentation. Or two oceanic plates can also divert or spread from each other. In this third scenario, two plates could also simply slide past each other. And this is the case with the famous St. Andreas Fault in California, involving the Pacific and the North American plates that caused a very big earthquake in San Francisco in 1906. But close by, we also had an earthquake as a result of this kind of plates sliding past each other in 2012 in the Indian Ocean. More on this later. And as a result of these earthquakes, our geodetic infrastructures and our coordinate systems need to be reviewed. So that is why we need to continuously monitor the plate motion so that all coordinates of our infrastructures will always remain updated and relevant with time. And this slide shows the tectonic plate motion involving the Sundaland block and its neighboring plates, where we use GPS data from 1994 to 2003. As you may notice, for the majority of Southeast Asia, which includes Indochina, Thailand, Peninsula Malaysia, parts of Sumatra, Java and Borneo, the Sundaland plate makes up a single tectonic block. It has a rigid core but experiences significant deformation close to its boundaries. And on a closer look at this slide, it shows the predicted tectonic plate motions on a global scale. Our plate is moving southeast at the rate of about 3 centimeters per year. Now our coordinate system is based on GDM 2000 datum, meaning that this set of coordinates are accurate on the 1st of January in the year 2000. So if you did your survey work on the 1st of June, for example, in 2020, and tied to our geodetic stations or use our multi-kinet stations, then you need to bring your coordinates back to the 1st January in the year 2000, just by applying this simple formula, which is the displacement is equal to the plate velocity multiplied by the time. So in this case, it is 3 centimeters per year multiplied by the time, which is the year 2020 minus the year 2000, is roughly about 20 years. So you get about 58.5 centimeters, close to 60 centimeters of motion. And you need to apply this correction to your coordinates. It is only then that you can process your GPS data to obtain your station coordinates and be consistent with our maps or our databases, if you are using our maps or database as your base. You can use this formula here to bring your working coordinates to whatever year you want. Ladies and gentlemen, in view of the need to continuously monitor the coordinates of our geodetic networks, JUPEM established a permanent GPS tracking station known as the Malaysia Active GPS System, or MAS for short, at the end of 1998, with 18 stations making up the whole infrastructure. And we use GPS data obtained from the IGS stations, and the coordinates of MAS station were derived from 4 years of continuous GPS data. That is from 1999 to the year 2002. It is this MAS coordinates that represent the basis for the determination of GDM 2000 that was launched on 26 August 2003. So ladies and gentlemen, everything looks fine with our Earth. Spinning happily on its axis, the Earth is happily orbiting around the Sun, the sea floor is spreading happily, the tectonic plates are floating away happily. JUPEM had already launched its GDM 2000. We have documented our coordinate reference system via KPUP circular number 1 of 2009, dated 25th of May. We also have established transformation perimeters and map projections via KPUP circular number 3 of 2009, dated 5th of June, for the different datums that we have: Kertau, Timbalai, WJ84 datum, geocentric RSO, geocentric Cassini. So we have all sort of transformation parameters. We computed station velocities for you to apply in order to transform your fixed coordinates to your working epoch. So everybody is happy. Except, of course, you all have to pay for our data, the multi-K-net services, as well as the transformation parameters. But apart from that, everybody is happy. And so it seems, until one dreadful morning, one dreadful day after Christmas in 2004, when an earthquake hit Aceh. Of course, small and moderate earthquakes do occur daily in South Asia, in Southeast Asia. But on 26th of December 2004, there was a giant one, a mega earthquake at a magnitude of 9.3 Richter scale, struck Bandar Aceh at around 9 a.m. local time. It triggered a tsunami that devastated this region. It was reported that the waves traveled the ocean at the speed of up to 700 kilometers per hour. And the graphs on the right here represent sea levels from JUPEM tide gauge stations in Peninsular Malaysia. And as you can see, the waves reached Langkawi about 3 hours later, at around 12:30 in the afternoon. The waves then hit Penang at 1:30 p.m. and the waves sort of started to die off after reaching Kelang around 4:30 p.m. And it was reported that when the waves reached the Aceh coastline, the heights of the waves were about 30 meters, and the effects of this tsunami were just beyond words, ladies and gentlemen. Just take a look at these photos here. 68 people died in Malaysia alone, but globally, more than 200,000 people perished their lives in this tragedy. And the entire region was deformed co-seismically on 26th of December 2004, and of course had generated the deadly tsunami and up to 5 meters displacement near field, with Thailand, Malaysia, Vietnam experiencing a displacement of about 1 to 25 centimeters. And presently, that is significantly an ongoing post-seismic deformation in our area. And as though, as it was not bad enough, another earthquake hit this region in Nias on 28 March 2005, and then another struck again in Bengkulu on 12 September 2007. And these yellow dots that you are seeing are actually aftershocks, small earthquakes commonly associated with bigger ones. And results indicate that the displacement of multi-K-net stations due to the co-seismic motion from 2004 earthquake in Sumatra was between 1.5 to 17 centimeters as a result of this Aceh earthquake. And it occurs predominantly in the southwest direction as represented by the yellow arrows here. Similarly, the results from 2005 indicate displacements of between 1 to 6.5 centimeters in the southwest direction, and the results from the 2000 earthquakes indicate displacements of between 1 to 3 centimeters also in the southwest direction. So ladies and gentlemen, what this slide and the previous two slides had shown is that there are displacement vectors from the post-seismic motions continuously demonstrate an anti-clockwise rotation, thus indicating a possible return to the effect of tectonic plate motion. Of course, eventually the post-seismic deformation will reach a final value, and that can be considered as a constant after many, many years. Some say that it would take more than 50 years to return to normality. So if we were to total up all the co-seismic displacement caused by the three earthquakes between 2004 and 2009, the magnitude of the displacements ranged from 1 cm to 25.8 centimeters towards the southwest. If we were to consider our motion due to the plate tectonic motion alone minus the earthquake, it is 3 centimeters per year towards southeast. This means that we are back to our position about 8.5 years ago. That is 25.8 centimeters. You divide by 3 centimeters by 3 centimeters per year, you will get 8.5 years. And that will be in 1999 roughly. Yeah? 1999 position, that is 2007. Is about 2007 minus 1999 is about 8.5 years. So meaning that if you were in the year 2007, your position was actually in the year 1999. So amazing, isn't it? It just demonstrates to us the total power of those three earthquakes in moving our positions. And as if that were not enough, ladies and gentlemen, another two more big earthquakes called the Indian Ocean earthquake of magnitude 8.6 and 8.2 Richter scale struck near the Indonesian province of Aceh on 11 April 2012 at around 3:38 local time. And they were intraplate earthquakes, meaning that they occurred within the interior of a tectonic plate as opposed to an interplate earthquake which occurs at the boundary of a tectonic plate. And these two earthquakes were of strike slip earthquake, meaning that the movement displaced relatively little seawater and was less likely to cause a tsunami. So we have computed the impact of those earthquakes, of those 2012 earthquakes, and the results indicated that the displacement of our Mark Atiket stations due to the co-seismic motion from the earthquakes was between 0.3 to 4.8 centimeters, occurring predominantly in the northeast direction, as represented by the red arrows here. So these results are quite interesting, ladies and gentlemen. The previous three earthquakes from 2004 to 2007 had pushed us back 8.5 years, but the 2012 earthquakes had pushed us forward to by almost 1.5 years. So again, if we were to total up all the co-seismic displacements caused by the five earthquakes between 2004 and 2012, the magnitude of the displacements range from 8.3 to 27.5 centimeters towards all sort of directions, really. The northern region of Peninsular Malaysia had moved about 27 centimeters in the southwest direction, while the east coast of Peninsular Malaysia moved about 20 centimeters in the southeast direction. Sabah and Sarawak are fairly uniform in its motion, about 20 centimeters also in the southeast direction. So the effects of those five earthquakes, ladies and gentlemen, has distorted the shape of Malaysia. These displacements are significant, ladies and gentlemen, and that ones that we cannot neglect. The earthquakes have generated motions and caused significant displacements to the geodetic infrastructures in Malaysia, which need to be modelled. Consequently, their GDM 2000 coordinates cannot be further utilised for high-precision survey and they need to be revised. Therefore, our coordinate reference systems have to be redone. And that's what we did. We recomputed the GDM 2000 coordinates using data from 1st of January 2006 to 30th April 2009, brought back all the coordinates to 1st January of 2000 because that is our GDM 2000 using velocity models, and thus the resulting coordinates, we call it as GDM 2000 in bracket 2009. So now you have another set of transformation parameters to purchase, ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen, I am coming close to the end now with a few more slides to go. So what is next? This GDM 2000 in bracket 2009 would be continuously maintained and managed through the use of MAN-RTKNET permanent tracking stations to ensure the availability of a highly accurate, homogeneous and up-to-date data for Malaysia. And in this respect, we are currently in the process of coming up with a new data to replace GDM 2000. It is called GDM 2020 and we are going to launch it next year, inshallah. And of course, we will come up with DG circulars to explain on the transformation aspects of the coordinates involved. Number two, we have also set up several sub-working groups under the GP-N to oversee the geodetic activities in Malaysia. Number three, I have set up a Bernese group comprising lecturers and researchers to work with us at JUPERM so that we have a continuous programs for capacity building. Number four, we have reinitiated the ASEAN EU University Network Program comprising of Department of Earth Observation and Space System, DIOS of Netherlands, JUPERM, Chulalongkorn University in Bangkok, Thailand, BIG in Indonesia, UTM Johor and ITB Bandung, where one of the projects that we have tried to bring back is the Sea Mergers project. We have also completed the implementation of real-time sea level monitoring, where all the 21 tide gauges are now equipped with telemetry link so that we can receive the sea level heights information in real time. And this will certainly be helpful in the tsunami as a tsunami early warning initiative. We have set up a team of researchers comprising members from JUPERM, JMM, JMG, UTM, UITM and UTHO to investigate the geodynamic activities in Ranau, Sabah, where we had successfully carried out 3 GPS observation campaigns to further understand the geodynamic process over there. This is the control center at my office in Kuala Lumpur. The graphs show you the actual sea level heights at the ports in real time. So if anything happens, we have got the luxury to inform our friends over there first. And these are some of the photos taken following the 2015 earthquake in Ranau, Sabah. The GPS field observation in Sabah on the 11 June 2015 after we experienced the earthquake in Gunung Kinabalu. And finally, I would like to leave you all with a verse from the Holy Quran Surah Al-Anbiya, verse 31 to 33. And we have set on the earth mountains standing firm, lest it should shake with them. And we have made therein broad highways between mountains for them to pass through, that they may receive guidance. And we have made the heavens as a canopy well guarded. Yet do they turn away from the signs which these things point to? It is He who created the night and day, and the sun and the moon. All the celestial bodies swim along, each in its rounded course. Thank you. Wabillahi taufiq wal hidayah. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.